So, what is anthropology? Well, the term anthropology comes from the Greek words anthropos, meaning man, human, and logos, meaning the study of. At its most basic, anthropology is the study of humans, cross-culturally and through time. Anthropology studies the behaviors, the physiology, and the material culture of living and ancient societies, as well as the past and present of our nearest biological relatives, the primates. Now, while many other disciplines study humans and human behavior, anthropology uses a holistic, comparative approach to the study of living and past populations. By holistic, I mean that anthropology is a multifaceted way of looking at societies that requires knowledge of all aspects of society, their beliefs, practices, environment, and biology, in order to really understand any part of it. For example, if an anthropologist is interested in the religion of a particular group of people, he or she must look at the physical environment the group lives in, how they obtain food, their gender roles, social hierarchy, education, etc., in order to really understand why the group has the religious beliefs that they do. Also, anthropology realizes that human biology, behavior, and material culture are all linked. This means that anthropology looks for cultural explanations for biological phenomena, like how the Western diet affects aged menarche and heart disease and diabetes, and biological reasons behind cultural practices, such as genetic links for behaviors like alcoholism or schizophrenia. On the whole, anthropology is a cross-disciplinary subject. We study art, music, politics, agriculture, technology, economy, identity, botany, hunting, and more. And it's because anthropology is holistic that we can get a much more accurate view as to why a society acts a certain way it does. Now, the comparative facet of anthropology means that we compare behaviors and practices between societies. Doing so helps us to establish connections between groups that may have been a single group in the past, may have had contact with one another, like through mediums such as trade, or simply have responded to similar stimuli in the same way. For example, there are many groups of people who live near the oceans and collect shellfish as their main food source. This is simply a response to the fact that shellfish are plentiful and easy to obtain in that environment. On the other hand, we find identical stone tools 16 to 19,000 years ago in Europe, called Solutrean there, and in the Americas, where we call them Clovis tools. It's likely that there's some connection between these populations. This has suggested that some groups of humans migrated directly from Europe across the Atlantic, probably following the edge of the northern glacier ice sheets, sometime between 16,000 and 19,000 years ago. In addition to being holistic and comparative, anthropology is also evolutionary. Now, evolution simply means change over time. It doesn't mean an increase in complexity or any sort of progression towards a specific form or goal. What this means is that anthropologists look at how humans change. Now, this can be physically. For example, most of us are taller than our grandparents, and many modern humans are born without one or more of our wisdom teeth. Or it can be culturally, where things like technology improvements have dramatically changed our behaviors and beliefs over the years. There are four main fields within anthropology that focus on particular aspects of humans. Though all are holistic and information is borrowed back and forth between our subfields. Now, the four fields are social cultural anthropology, archaeology, anthropological linguistics, and physical or biological anthropology. Archaeology attempts to reconstruct the behaviors and beliefs and practices of past populations by looking at the material attributes, the artifacts that remain after culture has died or moved elsewhere. Archaeologists excavate the remains of a group of people who are no longer living in an area, and then use these remains to answer questions about maybe subsistence, how they got their food, economy, trade, and possibly link these past populations with living cultures nearby or somewhere else around the world. Archaeology is also conducted on historical sites, places that have been abandoned or destroyed, and can be used then to verify historical documentation on events. Sociocultural anthropology is similar to archaeology in focus. The main difference, though, is that sociocultural, instead of reconstructing past populations the way archaeology does, cultural observes and analyzes the beliefs and practices of living populations. Cultural anthropology seeks to understand the reasons for the different beliefs and practices of societies around the world, as well as how and why different patterns of behavior have evolved, and how a society develops and changes over time, especially currently with the globalization of our modern world. So in cultural research, the goals are more focused on why, whereas in archaeology, it's more on what. Now, linguistic anthropology studies human languages, their similarities, their differences, how they change, and how language and culture interact. Linguistic anthropologists address diverse questions such as how language variations, like accents or dialects, influence an individual's cultural perspective, how males and females communicate differently, and attempt to do some reconstruction of ancient languages. Physical anthropology, our focus, addresses the biological basis of humans, specifically focusing on evolution of the physical body and human ancestors, anatomy and physiology, and our primate relatives. Now, there are three main subfields within physical anthropology: genetics and human variation, primatology, and paleoanthropology. Genetics focuses on the similarities and differences between individuals at a genetic or cellular level, looking at the actual genes, how they came to be, why some individuals have certain genes and others don't, and how genes work to make everyone different. Human variation takes the genetics and looks at how an individual as a whole are both similar and different. Researchers studying human variation may look at human growth and development, how humans deal with environmental stressors like heat, cold, solar radiation, diet, etc., and why different populations of people have different genes, both in living populations and extinct populations. Now, human variation also addresses how humans have changed over time. Included in the field of human variation is also forensics, forensic anthropology. Because anthropology studies past populations as well as present ones, physical anthropologists are experts in human bones, which can be applied then to criminal cases in which the remains of a victim have become skeletonized. In these situations, forensic anthropologists are asked to determine who the individual was by looking at their sex, the age at death, and interpreting any trauma or disease present in the skeleton, just as they would in an ancient skeleton. Primatologists study the evolution and behavior of our nearest living and extinct biological relatives, the primates. Primates are the order of mammals that includes humans, apes, monkeys, and prosimians. Primatology usually focuses primarily on the genetics, anatomy, and behavior of the various primate species, in many ways similar to the way human variation looks at humans, and for many of the same reasons, specifically identifying why the different species have the different traits and behaviors that they do. They also look at why certain species survived while others became extinct. Looking at our closest relatives, it can help us to understand where our ancestors came from and why we have some of the traits that we do. Most primatologists, in addition to studying the living primates, work on conservation of living primates around the world, especially in terms of the great apes, who are highly threatened due to the bushmeat trade in Africa and the palm oil trade in Indonesia. Paleoanthropology is the study of the evolution and behavior of humans and our extinct biological relatives. In many ways, paleoanthropologists are the human variationists of the past. They use the fossilized bones of bipedal ape and more to reconstruct the evolutionary history of the human species, locating and identifying new species and fitting them into the human family tree. They're interested both in species that are on the direct ancestral line with modern humans, as well as those on side branches that have gone extinct. They also look at more recent species on the family tree, such as Homo erectus and Neanderthals, attempting to understand how and why they changed in morphology over time, and what behaviors they likely exhibited. For example, when did human ancestors start hunting or building fires? So now that we know what anthropology is, and more specifically what biological anthropology studies, why do you think it's important to understand? Why do we study it? Well, biological anthropology can help us to understand the difference between individuals. Why some individuals look one way while others look a different. For example, why do some people have straight hair and others coarse curly hair? Well, this has to do with heat and ancestry. Individuals whose ancestors lived in hot climates without a lot of trees needed coarse curly hair to insulate their heads and their brains to keep them from overheating in the heat of the day while the sun is beating down on their heads. While individuals whose ancestors lived in colder climates needed the straight hair to cover the back of their neck and their ears to prevent heat loss. This understanding of why traits are different in different populations can then help us combat biologically based racism. If we know why individuals have the traits they do, we can no longer really use those traits as an excuse to discriminate against individuals who have them. Lastly, an understanding of biological anthropology helps us to understand that we, as humans, are part of a long continuum of evolutionary change, and that as a species, we continue to change as our environment changes around us, the same way that all living things do.